opportunities which are there in the social space. Yeah, but before I get into what consulting is about, let's take a quick look at how are we going to go about the presentation. The presentation will be covered in 8 parts when we start beginning from what is a consultant, what is a consultant continuum that we're going to talk about, and we're going to move into the skills, stages of consulting, how do we build trust in as a consultant, traits, and finally I'm going to talk about consulting in the social space. Yes. Now, before we move into the details of the entire thing, let's take a look at who is a consultant, right? A consultant is basically somebody who provides expertise for a client, for a particular issue, a concern, opportunity, or problem, right? This is a very simple and a very basic definition of what a consultant is. Now, before I get into the whole concept of consulting, as an aspiring consultant, the first question I would ask myself is what is the reason why I want to do consulting, right? What am I offering, right? And who should I offer? Who are the people that I should offer my services to? And last, how should I price the services? Now, the entire concept of consulting, personally for me, is rooted on principles and values of your own, right? That's the first space that you start with, where you have some values of your own which you start off with. Now, well, while I was exploring the whole consultant continuum there, I was thinking of this as probably how I would go about it, right? Why do I want to do consulting? What is the purpose? Do I want to share my knowledge? Do I want to reach out to more people? What is the purpose of me doing consulting? Second, what am I offering? Basically, what is the knowledge that I'm sharing with everybody else that I am that I have, right? Whom should I offer? What is the network that I should tap into when I talk about consulting? Last but not the least, budget and pricing. How do I budget and price the services that I have, right? From there, I realized that there could be different types of consulting. When I was exploring the whole thing, I realized there are different types of consulting. Internal consultant versus an external consultant. Internal consultant is somebody who's within the organization. External is somebody that you bring from outside, right? There's also an expert versus a facilitator consultant. And last, there is an evaluator versus a subcontractor. I'm going to give a brief example of what each of them stand for. Internal consultant, I'm going to take the example of a consulting role that I played in MAD, where, for example, for foundation program, we had to expand to new shelters, right? So in my conversation with the foundation team, I consulted, they took advice from me as a consultant, talking about what are the shelters that they could expand into, right? Versus an external consultant. I feel Poonam is one of our external consultants that we have, who talks about different kind of shelters, what is the scope, what is the, what are the different stuff that we can do with shelters out there. Expert versus a facilitator, somebody who has a specific skill and knowledge on a particular domain which is transferred to the organization. Facilitator, basically somebody who goes beyond than what is asked, right? Last is an evaluator. Like, for example, I bring in a research team to evaluate on the current status of the organization. For example, the external evaluator that we got for our finance team to look at the different projects that we have, how much money we have, etc. Versus a subcontractor. It's an organization or a person to whom we give out a part of our operations to do some stuff within the organization. These are the three broad different types of being a consultant. All of this also has a different level of authority, right? Or say a decision-making power that you will have when you are a consultant. From there, I realized that there are some basic skills which are required. For the different types of consultant which I spoke about, there are some specifics which is there, but these are the broad skills that a consultant requires, from designing to solutioning, both practical and ID, planning, visioning, facilitation. Change management is one of the key skills of a consultant. Domain knowledge, what is the knowledge that I'm offering? Conflict resolution and aspects of financial understanding is also something that a consultant would require as a skill. Now, when we talk about consulting, I thought of breaking it down into 5 stages, which is easy for everybody to understand. I'm going to use an example which is within MAD, which will give us more clarity of what a consultant is. There are 5 stages that I looked up: understanding, setup, on ground. Then there's a consulting phase, and there's a disengagement stage that you have of a consultant. Right? Now, from there, let's look at the first stage, which is understanding. What is the stage comprised of? Right? First is defining the problem that you have as a consultant. Then we look at learning about the organization. So A, for example, if I want to be a consultant in MAT, I will look at what is the problem that is at hand, there are some things I need to know about the organization. I will also let the client learn about me. There are a few things that I do, this is the way I do, or these are the few things that it requires to be done. And last, understanding the present successes and failures of the organization, right? Now, I correlated the entire thing with shelter expansions. For example, if I'm taking a shelter, and I walk into a shelter and say I have some services to offer, which is basically the MAT services, I'm going to look at what is the problem that the shelter is dealing with, right? I'm going to learn more about the shelter that we plan to take, or the shelter that we want to work with. I'm going to talk more about what MAT does, what are the services that MAT does. And last, what are the successes and failures that the shelter has gone through, right? This is a very simple example of how you get into the stage of understanding. From there, I'm going to look at setup, where I'm going to look at what is the plan for action. Now that I've understood the organization has also learned about me, and I have a little bit of background also into the shelter. I'm going to look at what is the plan of action. From there, I'm going to look at a consultant's role. Basically, I have to get into a goal congruence. That is, both of us have to agree that this is what is the outcome, or this is what we are looking to achieve at the end of the day, right? What is the project status? So, when do I start the project? When do I end the project? What are the complexities that is involved there? Last is also the fees. How much am I going to charge, right? An example that comes to my mind, fees is also something that is based on complexity, the duration, etc. So one of my friends, her brother-in-law works in a consultant firm in Africa. And one of the things that the agreement had in the entire thing was that if you get kidnapped more than 3 times, the organization will only pay for 3 ransoms. Mm-hmm. Right? So his fees was included in that, right? So when you work for organizations as tricky as this, do ensure that you put ransom costs also as your fees, right? So that's also that's one big thing that we need to look at when we talk about fees. Now, so we've looked at the first 2 stages of understanding. We've looked at what is set up. Now we're going to get at the actual stuff, which is going on ground, right? Yes. So when we're on ground, which is stage 3, moving on from setup to on ground, we are basically preparing for the visit. What am I going to do on ground? What am I going to see on ground, right? I'm also going to look at, when I'm visiting, what are the things that I'm going to actually do there, right? Which involves the looking, understanding what the key players, who are the staff that is involved in the organization, and I'm going to understand the organization a lot more from the people with whom I'm going to interact. Finally, I have to take a call whether I still want to consult, right? I've understood the organization, I've met the people, do I really want to get into consulting, right? This is also the stage that we get into when we go for shelter expansions. Finally, do I really want to expand into the shelter once I have understood all of the aspects, right? Now is the final stage of consulting, where the first stage is conceptual agreement, where I'm formalizing the agreement with the concerned client that this is the services that I'm going to offer. The best part of having a conceptual agreement is that it also prevents, though it lays down the things that you will do, it also lays down the things that you will not do, right? A term that is used is called a scope creep, where for example, okay, so now you're doing A and B, so it's okay if you do C and D as well, right? Mm-hmm. But the agreement will clearly say what are the things that you will do and the things that you will not do. It's extreme. It's very similar to the MOU that we signed earlier with the shelter authorities, right? So that's a conceptual agreement. Then for example, once the agreement is shared, if there are some changes which is required, we go back and revise the agreement based on the feedback that you have received. From there, we look at gaining and establishing trust, right, with the organization. You also need to establish trust with the people that you are going to work with. And last part of this is implementing the strategy that you have devised for the organization. Now, from this slide, I'm going to move on to something which is extremely critical, which is this point that is highlighted here on establishing and gaining trust, and why is it important, right? Now, when I was thinking about the whole thing of consulting, I realized that personal credibility or trust is very important. Now, why am I talking about trust? I chanced upon something called as the organizational iceberg. If you look at the diagram, all your shared assumptions, your procedures, your tradition, your values, they are below this, right? The things that you see on top, vision, strategy, they have a very small aspect to play, but there are a lot of hidden things which are there in the organization which you need to know beforehand, right? Even though we say that vision and strategy and shared values or structures are the way we get things done, but the real way of getting things done is through the feelings, the beliefs, the perceptions that is there in the organization. So it's very important for you as a consultant to know what these values are and how it works in the organization, right? Now, what is trust? trust is not a very soft, mushy feeling that you have with a person, or okay, I trust the person, right? It's much more complex than that. It is, it's a confidence that you have in another person. Confidence in the person's abilities, confidence in the person's intentions, and confidence in the person's capabilities, right? And all those things are what makes it worth to work in an organization, right? Now, how do you build trust? What are the different ways to build trust? A very simple definition or a very simple way to go about is that trust is based on personal credibility. The first step of building trust is trust within yourself, right? And there are four different ways of doing that. There are four different core principles of building trust. One is definitely the intent that you have. What is the intention with which you're going into the organization, your motives, right? Second is integrity. Integrity being extremely crucial. Being what you are inside, you also need to be the same outside as well, right? Your capabilities, which is basically your abilities with confidence. What are the abilities that you have, right? Which is it has to do with your abilities, your confidence that you have in people. It also has to do with some style that you bring of your own, right? And the last is also your track record. What are the results that you have produced? There's no point if you have skills and you have good intent, but you have no track record, or you have you've not produced any sort of results, right? So there are different ways. These are the four different ways of how you build trust in an organization. Also, how you pass on trust to another person, right? Now we've looked at the four different stages of consulting. I'm going to look at the last stage of consulting, which talks about disengagement. It is as crucial as the other four stages. What does disengagement contain of? Yes, it contains of these four things. Now, when we are moving out of an organization, I know that my term is going to end in an organization, I need to find two key needs. Or if the organization is small, I find as many people as possible who can pass on the learnings that I have shared with the organization. Right? It also talks about the conclusion of the project. So not to talk about conclusion when you're concluding it, but when you're midway, you talk about, okay, so now I'm not going to be here for the next 3 years, or I'm going to be leaving after 2 months. What are the things that you're going to do? How are you going to pass it on? Right? Ensuring all the knowledge and resources which are there is documented. All your documentation is in place. And finally, transition, the stage when you have to move out. Right? These are the five different stages of being a consultant, and disengagement is an extremely crucial part of it, because if you're not doing this properly, all that you've done in the past four stages will be wasted, right? Now, what are the traits that is required to be a consultant? Professionalism, resilience, diagnostic rather than being prescriptive. In the example that I gave, a foundation team where we had given details of the shelters that they could expand to. For me, it was easy to just, okay, now you can expand to six shelters. But I also gave examples of shelters where it may not be viable for you to expand. Or I did not give examples of shelters where there are problems, right? So you have to give a little bit more than what is asked. Design based on implementing the solution. It doesn't matter if your idea is fancy. If it cannot be implemented, it's better not to give that out. Ability to tweak the existing models. You cannot create new structures every day. What are the existing models that you have which can be used with another organization, right? Now, okay, so now in the entire process of understanding what are the opportunities in the social space, I'm going to come to the last bit, which is talking about consulting in the social space, right? Now, consulting in the social space is something which is different. It is very different from working in a non-profit sector. Right. Now, when I was thinking of the entire thing, I chanced upon a few things. One of the things is to bring about paradigm shift, right? And this is done through designing children's homes instead of shelter homes. Even though nomenclatures have changed from a shelter home to children's home, but the way it is done, or the way things are managed in the home, is the same way that you would run a rescue home or a shelter home. Right? This is a space that really needs to be changed. This paradigm shift is extremely crucial. Right? From there, I looked at whatever system, we need to do a systems analysis. There are a lot of processes which are in the shelter, which are just unnecessary, right? Which are there because of some bad practice that they have, or some bad experience which the shelters have, which is why they feel that those processes should be there. We need to relook at a couple of those processes which are there in these rooms, right? And what we also need to look at building personal capacity. There are a lot of our new problems that shelters face is based on the old problems that is there, right? It's based on old solutions which are there. Now we need to train our caregivers, we need to train the shelter staff that is out there, right? We need to give them the different techniques of, for example, bringing up children, different concepts of parenting. Even also talking to them about fundraising. There are shelter homes which are not aware about how to go about fundraising. And we could do this probably with different kind of workshops or sensitization programs, etc. Right? And it's about building grassroots change makers. You need to start from there. Change starts from there. Right? And we need to educate. We need to empower the change makers. Right? We have a lot of people who come to us who want to donate things for children. But what they actually don't realize is that that is not what the child needs. Right? Now, example that I was thinking of is my interaction with Gopi from Give India. When I was speaking to her about the shelter homes, she was under the assumption that all the children who are there in shelter homes are orphans. They don't have anybody. Right? And there are so many assumptions which are out there, which is not helping the situation. So we really need to get into a space of educating and empowering the change makers. Right? And then definitely one big aspect is networking. When I talk to shelter authorities, they don't know that another shelter exists two streets away. Right? And if they do a lot of collaboration, a lot of change can happen, which is where our shelter authority conference plays a key role. Right? One of the different kinds of a consultant is also a convener, a person who brings everybody together, right? Who ensures that there is knowledge transfer which happens, right? Which is basically connecting the dots between the shelters. Right? And one of the things that shelters or homes, these homes often miss is to measure what we treasure, which is basically the value of data. Right? If, for example, in Ashadi, there are all the children who have passed away from that home, they don't come back to the shelter. What is the reason why they don't want to come back? If you look at some of those key numbers in a shelter home, you can really make the shifts and the changes in these homes. Right? And also, giving what is right, not what is left. Mm. Right? This I chanced upon when I was looking for admission for my son. And I realized that a good Montessori education would cost around 60,000. Right? But what is the kind of education that our children get? It's something which is left up. Nobody wants that kind of education. Right? And which is a space of childcare practices, giving the best and the optimal to the children. Right? And influence policy making. If you don't have any grassroots knowledge, you cannot influence policy making. Also, it is about ones that can be implemented. There are a lot of policies out there which cannot be implemented, right? And policies which are needed. There are not many policies which are needed, which are required and are out there, right? And I'm rushing because of time. Yes. Now I'm going to explore what are the golden rules of consulting, and this is my best part of my favorite part of the presentation. When to put up, shut up, give up, and stand up. Right? This is based, as a consultant, this is based on your values, skills, and awareness. You may have your values and skills in place, but if you're not aware, you cannot stand up for anything. Right? If you have awareness and you have values, but you have no skills, you cannot do any of these things. An example that I can give off is, in 2011, there was a Times Group in Trivandrum who had approached us to do a marathon event. Right, and so the way we got it was through one of our volunteers, and I asked him the details of why they want to do the marathon, etc. From that interaction, I realized that the marathon was sponsored by a chemical firm called Dow Chemicals. I don't know how many people this name clicks, but this is the chemical organization that was behind the Bhopal gas tragedy that took place in 1984. For me, it could have been very easy to just say, okay, they won't go ahead with the marathon. It looks nice, right? And because they had promised that they will not, that they will ensure that the name of Dow Chemicals doesn't come in the newspaper. For me, it was easier, okay, so let's go ahead. Let's do this. It doesn't matter. It's giving us good publicity. And that was a time when we were even looking for equipment drives in the city, right? So it's very important to know these things to be able to do this. And as a consultant, this is one of the key skills that you will need, right? Not to be attached to your solutions and designs. It is very important, right? An example that I can give of is a primary curriculum which I had designed, right? 3 years back, it's something that I designed and it was used for 3 years, right? But now it is used to increase the level of the laptop and monitors in different rooms, right? But I can't go about weeping and say, oh, it was my design. It's really useful. I know how it was made. I made it in 10 days, right? So those are things that you need to be aware of, not to be linked to any of the solutions and designs that you create. a white savior complex. You cannot save everybody. You cannot save everything. Right? Over the past 7 years, Make a Difference has dropped 48 shelters, and they account easily for 1,000 children. Right? When I go for a shelter expansion, I can easily say, now I'm going to take back all the 48 shelters. Right? But it really doesn't make sense to go that way. Right? You cannot save everybody. So this is also a complex that we should not get into. And last, what I did throughout the presentation, blow your own horn. Nobody's going to do that for you. Right? You need to talk about the skills, the awareness, and the values that you have to get into the space. Yes? Thank you so much.